Part 1, The Discovery. I've been married for 9 years and my job has always required me to travel. At first, it was something I worried about, being away from home and the potential strain it might place on my marriage. Over time, though, I convinced myself that it wasn't an issue. Our routine settled into a rhythm. I'd leave for a few days and we'd reconnect when I returned. This trip was supposed to be no different. I had a 3-day business trip scheduled in San Francisco for a client presentation. I packed my suitcase the night before and spent the evening at home, making small talk over dinner. She seemed normal, perhaps a little distracted, but I didn't think much of it. We were both busy people, after all, and I assumed her mind was preoccupied with work. The flight out was smooth, and the first 2 days of the trip were uneventful. We exchanged our usual texts, brief updates about our days, a photo of the view from my hotel window, and her asking me to pick up something from the airport on the way back. But by the third day, her responses became slower, shorter. I shrugged it off, thinking she might be having a tough week at work. When I got home, I immediately noticed something was off. She was friendly enough but distant, almost as if she was distracted. It wasn't obvious, more like a subtle change in her demeanor. I asked how her week had been, and she gave vague answers about how nothing interesting had happened. That night, I went to bed with an uneasy feeling I couldn't explain. A few days later, I was unpacking my suitcase, a task I normally put off for days. As I unzipped a small side pocket, I found something that stopped me in my tracks. It was an earring, small, silver, and definitely not hers. I froze, staring at it, trying to come up with an explanation that didn't point to the worst. Maybe it fell in by accident at the hotel. Maybe it belonged to someone who used the room before me. But as much as I wanted to believe that the placement of the earring didn't fit, it was tucked away in a pocket I rarely use. I decided to ask her about it that evening. I tried to keep my tone casual. As I showed her the earring, she glanced at it briefly and said, "I don't know whose that is. Maybe it's from the hotel." Her answer was so quick, so dismissive, that it only added to my unease. She didn't ask any questions or seem surprised by the discovery. Instead, she told me I should call the hotel to check. The conversation ended there, but my suspicions didn't. That night, I couldn't sleep. Her reaction kept replaying in my mind. It didn't make sense, and I couldn't shake the feeling that she was hiding something. The next day, while she was at work, I decided to do something I'd never done before. I went through her things. I started with our tablet we both use, which she sometimes used for messaging and social media. It was logged into her accounts, so I had access to her messages. I didn't find anything outright incriminating, but there were a few conversations that raised red flags. One was with a coworker I vaguely knew of, a man she'd mentioned once or twice in passing. Their messages weren't overtly romantic or sexual, but they were far too personal for my liking. Late night exchanges, inside jokes, and comments that felt flirtatious in tone. My heart sank as I read through them, but I knew this wasn't enough to confront her. I needed more proof. I decided to check the footage from our home security camera. We had a camera installed at the front door to keep an eye on packages and visitors. As I reviewed the recordings from the weekend I was away, I noticed something strange. On one of the nights, two men arrived at the house minutes apart. Both stayed for several hours before leaving. My stomach churned as I watched the footage. I replayed it multiple times, hoping I'd misunderstood the timestamps or missed some innocent explanation. But there it was, plain as day, two strangers entering my home while I was away. It was undeniable, and the implications were crushing. Part 2, The Confrontation. After discovering the security footage, I knew I couldn't confront her without more information. The evidence I had was compelling, but it wasn't enough to confirm the full extent of her actions. I needed undeniable proof, something that would make her lies impossible to maintain. The next morning, I called a private investigator. It felt surreal explaining my situation to a stranger, but I had no other options, and I wasn't going to confront her until I had all the proof I needed. The investigator was professional and a matter of fact. He suggested placing a tracker on her car and monitoring her activities for a week. It sounded intrusive, but I agreed. I needed answers. While the investigator did his work, I tried to stay calm and act normal. It wasn't easy. Every time I looked at her, I felt a mixture of confusion and suspicion. She acted as though everything was fine, going about her daily routine as if nothing had changed. I wondered how she could be so calm if she was hiding something so serious. 4 days later, the investigator called me with an update. He had followed her during her lunch breaks and discovered she had visited a local hotel twice in the past week. Each time, she met with the coworker I had seen in her messages. The investigator provided photos of them entering and leaving the hotel together. While they didn't show anything explicitly inappropriate, the context was damning. Armed with this new information, I decided it was time to confront her. That evening, I waited until after dinner to bring it up. I started by asking about her coworker. Her reaction was immediate. She froze for a split second before brushing off my question with a casual, "Why are you asking about him?" I pressed further, mentioning the messages I had seen. Her expression shifted from calm to defensive. She denied any wrongdoing, claiming their conversations were harmless. When I brought up the hotel visits, her face turned pale. She sounded like she was tripping over her words, trying to come up with an explanation, but I cut her off. "I hired a private investigator. I know you've been meeting him at a hotel. I have photos." The room fell silent. She didn't deny it. Instead, she started crying and saying it was a mistake, that she had been feeling lonely and disconnected. She insisted it was only emotional and had never crossed into physical infidelity. I didn't believe her. "What about the men from the security footage?" I asked. Her eyes widened in shock, and she opened her mouth to speak, but said nothing. That reaction told me everything I needed to know. Eventually, she admitted to inviting them over, but insisted it was just a get-together with some friends. Her story didn't add up, and I wasn't interested in hearing more lies. At that moment, I knew our marriage was finished. That night, I packed a bag and left the house. I needed space to think without her presence clouding my judgment. As I closed the door behind me, I felt a strange sense of clarity. I didn't know what the future held, but I knew I couldn't stay in that house that night, or a marriage built on lies. Part 3. The aftermath. Leaving the house that night was the hardest thing I'd ever done, but I knew it was the right decision. I stayed with a close friend who offered me a place to clear my head. The next morning, I began taking steps to protect myself. My first call was to a lawyer. The lawyer listened patiently as I explained everything. He advised me to gather as much evidence as possible, especially if infidelity played a role in the divorce proceedings. I handed over the photos, security footage, and the PI's report. He assured me that I had a strong case and recommended I begin separating our finances immediately. Back at home, she bombarded me with messages. At first, they were apologetic, long texts explaining how lonely she had felt, how my frequent travel had made her feel isolated and lonely. Then came the pleas for forgiveness. She promised to go to counseling, to do whatever it took to fix things. When I didn't respond, her tone shifted. She accused me of abandoning her, of overreacting to a mistake. Her family got involved shortly after. Her sister called me, pleading on her behalf. "She's been struggling lately," she said. "She knows she messed up, but she loves you. Don't throw away everything you've built together." I didn't respond. It wasn't their marriage to save, and I wasn't interested in their opinions. The next few weeks were a blur of paperwork, meetings with my lawyer, and tense interactions at the house. I tried to avoid being there when she was home, but on the few occasions we crossed paths, the conversations were strained. She kept asking for another chance, insisting she'd cut off contact with the coworker and never see the other men again. I didn't believe her. Then I discovered something that sealed the deal. While organizing documents for the divorce, I stumbled across a second phone hidden in the back of her desk drawer. It was an older model Android, one I'd never seen before. When I turned it on, my suspicions were confirmed. The phone was filled with messages to multiple men, including explicit photos and videos. Some of the messages were dated as far back as 2 years ago. I didn't confront her about the phone. There was no point. Instead, I handed it over to my lawyer as further evidence. It was clear to me now that this wasn't a one-time mistake or a moment of weakness. This was a pattern of behavior, and there was no coming back from it. The divorce proceedings were contentious. She fought for the house, claiming she deserved it because I was the one who left. My lawyer countered with the mountain of evidence we'd collected, and in the end, I was awarded the property. She received a modest settlement, but nothing close to what she had demanded. Part 4, moving forward. The divorce was finalized 6 months later. The day I signed the papers, I felt a strange mix of relief and sadness. While I was glad to finally have closure, the reality of ending a 9-year marriage wasn't easy to accept. I had invested so much into a relationship that turned out to be built on lies. She moved out of the house shortly after the settlement was finalized. As far as I know, she's still seeing the coworker. The thought doesn't bother me anymore. If anything, I feel sorry for him. He's inheriting someone who couldn't even be honest in her own marriage. In the months following the divorce, I focused on rebuilding my life. I started going to therapy, not because I wanted to forgive her, but because I needed to understand why I ignored the warning signs for so long. My therapist helped me recognize patterns I hadn't noticed before. Small red flags I had dismissed over the years, thinking they weren't a big deal. I also reconnected with old friends, many of whom I drifted apart from during my marriage. It felt good to have a support system, people who reminded me of who I was before everything fell apart. I started picking up hobbies I'd abandoned. Slowly but surely, I began to feel like myself again. She reached out a few times in the first year after the divorce. At first, it was under the guise of wanting to check in, but it quickly became clear that she was hoping for reconciliation. She claimed to have changed, that she'd done the work to become a better person. I didn't respond. There was nothing left to say. The trust was gone, and there was no rebuilding it. Looking back, I can't believe how blind I was to the signs, the missed calls, the evasive answers. The sudden changes in her behavior, they were all there, but I chose to ignore them. I've learned to trust my instincts now. If something feels off, it probably is. A year later, I'm in a much better place. The pain of betrayal has faded, replaced by a sense of freedom. I've started dating again. It's a slow process, but I'm determined not to let my past define my future. If there's one thing I've learned, is that no matter how much you love someone, you can't ignore the truth. Trust is the foundation of any relationship, and once it's broken, it's nearly impossible to repair. I've made peace with what happened, and I'm ready to move forward.